जा आ जा उड़ धरती आ जा तेरे मन घर है जाना
We put our souls into these films. Films are made on the editing table. Anyone can shoot.
Mm.
We don't have the best cameramen in the world.
Mm.
But good footage will only get you that much.
Yeah.
It's what you do with that footage that makes the magic.
Vishal, welcome to Brown Game Strong.
Thank you for having me here.
It's so, so exciting to have you. I can't even explain. So we have a mutual friend and I saw on her Instagram story that you'd met up in London. And I was like, is that The Wedding Filmer? And I remember I messaged her and I was like, I'm such a fan. Like, The Wedding Filmer is like a dream person I'd love to interview because I have watched your videos over the years, like over the last probably decade. And I was, you know, too afraid to maybe ask for an introduction. So I just messaged you and I was like, you know, I'm just going to see what happens. And then we met up for coffee and you were literally one of the sweetest, you are one of the sweetest people I have ever met. And
well, you were equally warm yourself. It was easy to talk to you.
Oh,
it wasn't hard.
Thank you. I was baffled. I was like, let me figure out what the catch is here. I'm going to sit here during this coffee and try and figure it out. And there was no catch. You are truly wonderful, Vishal. Oh. So it's great to have you.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Good. There's no other place I'd rather be.
Oh, I'm sure there are.
Yeah.
My first question to you, Vishal, is do you believe in true love and soulmates?
Oh, yes, I do. I mean, I've been a romantic at heart. I've seen marriage up close. I've seen love up close. I've seen divorce and heartbreak up close since I've been born, literally. And you've also grown up on movies and, you know, the romance in it. And I went to a co-ed school and then I went to a boys' school. So I know what it's like to be without women in your life and to have women in your life. I was brought up by my mother and my sister because I did have an absent father at the time. And when you're brought up with women, it's different. You learn a certain, you have a certain idea about romance from them, I guess, in a sense. And my mom's a diehard romantic. My sister was a diehard romantic. And I guess so am I. Most Indians are. I think we drink too much milk. So it's the estrogen.
Oh, I love that answer. So you were brought up by women. And you said your father was not present. Did that play a part in why you chose a career that was so deep-rooted in celebrating all forms of love? Is that something that you feel like was a void that you were trying to fill at certain points?
So at some point in the last decade, I figured I needed therapy. So I went to a therapist.
Okay.
And one of the things we talked about in depth, which I don't think I ever realized, I never talked about it, was my parents' divorce when I was very young. And they both got married young. They both got divorced young, and it was very passionate love story, but it was also very aggressive and angry and love. But it was intense for those years that it was. And then they split up. My mother married again. My father married again. They both got divorced again. They both married again. They both got divorced again. And they went around the world from Santiago to Togo in Lomé and Benin. And then they went to India. They were in London. They were all over in Ghana, West Africa. And eventually they found themselves again at my sister's wedding. And they got married to each other again after like going around the world, finding other people. I guess that does play a role in your head. My sister, who's the most lovable person you would ever meet. I don't think there's a human being in this universe who doesn't like her because she does everything by the book. She's always right. She's always correct. She's always good. And even she went through a divorce. So, and it was shocking when it happened for me, at least. I least expected it. But just goes to show it can happen to anyone. But then marriage too can happen to anyone at any time. I'd given up on the idea of ever falling in love again. In fact, I used to always be scared of trying to fall in love again. You'd meet someone, you'd like them even, maybe there's a connection, but I'd never go further than that, just because I think subliminally I was scared. I didn't know it at the time, but I think eventually it took a long time and a lot of therapy and a lot of thought to be able to put yourself out there again and to give it everything all over again. And even then, it's the layers like an onion, you have to keep unraveling them.
Did you fall in love again, or did you find love?
I fell in love. I tried everything not to, and I know I did. I actively tried not to fall in love, and despite me trying not to fall in love, I fell. It's like, you know, you lose your balance. You can see it. You think, don't want to fall. It's like, no, but then you can't. Gravity is a bitch.
That is funny, because you know it's interesting, and I want to talk in depth about the work that you do, but you do work in the wedding industry, and you see love everywhere. How does that fairy tale, you know, rom-com version of love that you portray in your work reflect in your own personal life? Do you think that is real?
It's real for the people I film it for. It started off from a very true and very real place. The ability to be able to tell a story with a camera, with no gimmicks. The good thing about a wedding is you've got amazing production value. So you have beautiful fireworks, or you have beautiful outfits and amazing hairdos and amazing makeup and beautifully lit. And, you know, the flowers arrangements are really nice. And usually the music is on point, and the food's always great. And you can have a champagne in your hand, and you can have your camera in your hand, and you can have a great time doing what you're doing. But you're also doing something where it's not useless content. There's purpose to the content. It's meant to, A, preserve this time. It's meant to bring both people and both the families closer together. It's meant to serve as a reminder for why we did what we did and the things we said when we were younger. The value in what I do, like most beautiful things like cars and jewelry and things like that, come with time. And so that's why I try not to do Instagram reels and trendy things, and because it's the wedding films should stand the test of time. Even in the formats you shoot in, they should last really long. So the larger the format, the more resolution, the higher the tech, the better the sound, the better the way it's stored and remembered would give it that life that it needs, so that 50 years from now, it's accessible, it's watchable, and it's tangible content.
And it is. It's so watchable. It's beautiful. And I think for those listening, we haven't actually introduced you. So I would love for you to tell us what it is that you actually do and who actually is Vishal Punjabi.
Well, I'm a simple filmmaker. I've always wanted to be a filmmaker, and I'm an Indian filmmaker that is not born and bred in India. But now I live in India. So as an outsider who's come into India, I've tried to find my way there. And now I find myself moving back to London, which is where I studied and grew up. And I'm trying to fit in culturally and expand my circle in both these countries, and do it respectfully, I guess.
And you are also the creator of the wedding filmer.
I am. I film weddings for a living. I'm a wedding videographer. The Wedding Filmer is a company that I set up 13 years ago in 2010, when my son was being born, and I needed a career change. I desperately needed it. I felt it. And I guess the nice thing about my story is I felt something. I was doing something I loved, but I wanted to grow and I wanted to expand, and I couldn't do that where I was anymore. And so I decided to break out, and that took a lot of courage. And it there was a lot of fear, there was a lot of apprehension from everybody around me. A lot of people tried to stop me from doing it, but yet ahead, I went and I did it. And that's the one thing I'm proud of about my story, is I went ahead and made it, and we made it big, and we made it as big as it could get. I could have been bigger, I could have been sharper. I'm not a very smart businessman, but I've managed to create a nice bubble and a nice world for myself within what we do.
And what was the response after that first video that you released, which was your own?
I got married, and my ex-wife at the time, we're not married now anymore, she wanted a wedding video. And I was like, the wedding videos back then was that guy with the camera and he'd bend
over.
The one
that literally stands right in front of you, yes, and doesn't let you see anything about the bride and groom.
That one. And back then, though, it wasn't even as cool now, where we didn't have these small cameras. We had those big BD-150 cameras with a shotgun light. And the light had to be powered from the power source. So there was a cable running through everywhere.
Everyone's tripping over the cable.
Everyone's tripping over the cable. And he's bending over for some reason to shoot something. And you can see his bum crack.
Yes, I've seen the bum crack.
You've seen the bum crack. So the wedding, so I was like, nobody ever watches it. So my sister had a wedding video and we never watched it. There were 5 DVDs. They were just kept in the cupboard there and I never saw it. Well, thankfully that they got divorced.
But what about those 5 hours? Was it like those, you know, the ones where there's like a face and inside a flower and then it's rotating?
That was in my parents' time, right? Yeah. In the 70s and in the 80s, just to do that on VHS, which was tricky to do. And I guess somebody did it and they liked it then and it became a style. India has this it's that follow me mentality. So if one person does something and it does well, everybody tries to do the same thing. But there is only one real one. So back then too, they tried to do this. I felt if I'm going to make a wedding film, then I might as well make it entertaining and fun to watch and, you know, useful. So I said, I will shoot this wedding video. And this came from a hunger of wanting to shoot documentaries and short format and small format films, because I was working with Shah Rukh for a very long time. And I was his creative director in Red Chillies for about 10 years. And working on those cameras were not so much, they weren't fun. Like big cameras, you needed a whole crew to move them. You needed cranes and big dollies to move them. You needed a crew of 10 people to move them. And then the DSLR cameras launched, kind of like these ones. And you could press a button and record film, and you could use really nice lenses to make it look like movies. And I was like, oh, and it cost like a fraction and you don't need a crew. You can fit in your bag and you can shoot wherever you go and you can make movies now. Sound quality and technology got better. Softwares got better. Machines got faster. So now you could edit films at home. And that's what I started doing when I was in Africa. And that's what I was doing when I was in India. And that's what I was doing when I was in the UK. And I loved doing it. And it was beautiful. And I was like, why don't I just do this for Indian weddings and make them really nice? And I started doing that. And it just did exploded instantly. Like I set up from my bedroom, and within the first year I had to set up an office. Within the second year I had to set up a whole team. Within the third year it had grown to a proper full-fledged studio. And now it's a team of 50 people in two countries.
Do you feel like timing was important for you?
It was I was there at the right time. I was the first early bird. You know, somebody would have done it eventually.
YouTube was coming on the scene as well at the time.
YouTube was coming on the scene. There was no Instagram, only took pictures, no videos. Facebook was where we used to market our work on social media. So I had to get my social media game strong.
Love that.
I had to get people to help me with the phone calls, because like suddenly overnight the phone just went off the hook. It was beautiful. So setting up a company is always exciting, isn't it? Setting up the logo, then setting up the animation and the story and the ethos of the company and what it stands for and the brand guidelines. I loved all that. That was lots of fun. It's exciting.
Yeah. Were you very clear at the time of where you wanted the wedding filmer to go? Did you have a vision for it? Did you know what the brand would look like, or did you figure it out as you went along?
I did. I kind of knew in the beginning, and I kind of knew it would go really big. But even then, there were lots of people who were trying to stop me from doing it and keep it small and keep it tight and keep it. And I did for a long time. And keeping it small and keeping it tight meant I lost that advantage I wanted, that early bird advantage of growing big. But it also helped me like really understand and fine tune and tweak the company and make it solid and strong, which I have now. So I guess now is the time for me to make my vision really, really come true, which is basically... everybody's going to get married.
Yes.
Right? And everyone wants a good memory out of that wedding. It doesn't have to be necessarily a wedding video like the one I make, but it has to be something that works for them. The idea is to try and construct different formats to work for different people so that everybody gets a memory worth their wedding.
And it has to be an experience for them when they're revisiting.
It does. It has to be a piece of who they are and what they're remembering and why they're doing what they're doing, which is the purpose of a video. I guess we've forgotten that in the process. And every time I do a wedding, I keep remembering and I keep asking people, why am I doing this? What is the purpose of this video? And who's going to watch it? And what do I want to see? Because it's you're making a film, right? So there's so many voices. Is it from the point of view of the parents, which would be valid if it's an arranged marriage? Is it a point of view of the friends, which would be nice if it was a story about friends playing Cupid for a couple to meet? Or is it a story about the bride and groom who were hungry for love or lonely or had a really bad experience with love and suddenly found that they were not alone in the way they felt?
Mm. What's your why?
What's my why? In what way?
What's your reason for doing it?
What's my reason for doing it? The joy. It's very joyful. I used to do advertising with Shah Rukh for a long time. And when you do advertising, it's not very gratifying. I mean, you put in a lot of effort. We're artists, right? So when you create art, you're very proud of it. But advertising is not truly art. It's art to sell something.
Mm.
We try to be as creative as we can. And we think each film we've made should go to Cannes and win an award. And every time they ask for a change, I feel like they've desecrated this piece of work that I've made, which is like Michelangelo's painting, which is really not it. You're just doing it to sell toothpaste or a sanitary pad. But
yeah.
I guess what tends to happen is when you make a film and you show it to a couple, they laugh and they cry and they become family for life, because you're showing them something that I don't think they've seen themselves the way we see them when we film.
Yeah.
Because we try and look for the good in everyone and we hold on to that.
Yeah.
And then we celebrate that in the film that we make.
Mm.
And I think that's what makes it special for the people who watch it, because they know we care. They can see it in the effort that's put in the music and the edit and the technique. And it's not something that is formatted.
Yeah.
Each film is created from scratch. And that effort is where love comes from. I mean, love takes an effort, isn't it? To make a really good piece of work in terms of a lenga, you have to put in that time and you have to put in that effort. When your mom makes that perfect dessert or that perfect chicken curry, it's the effort and the love that goes into make it right. Same thing for the wedding film.
It's just a labor of love. A
labor of love, truly.
I want to take it back to when you were younger.
Mm-hmm.
I know we've chatted a little bit about your work, and we will continue to do so shortly. I want to touch on, you mentioned that you grew up in Ghana.
Mm-hmm.
You also told me you're a Sindhi,
I am. I'm a Sindhi boy from Ghana.
I love it. I just love hearing stories of Sindhis around the world, and what makes us tick, because I feel like there's a lot of similarities, definitely. And what was it like for you? You grew up in Accra, right?
I grew up in Accra. I was clueless.
Mm-hmm.
I was very creative, but I was very clueless.
Mm.
I didn't know my head from my ass back then. And also, it's a very sheltered life. You didn't know anything yet. You didn't know beyond the food that we ate, which was fufu and banku and okra stew and the local cuisine and the few friends that we had. And it's a very sheltered life growing up as a child, as a toddler and as a young boy. But it was also beautiful because it's very innocent. There's football, there's music, which was a big part of me in Ghana. And I had some really good music teachers in Africa. Rhythm is in their soul.
Yes, absolutely.
And the friends I made then are still my friends now. Okay. In a big way. We're not as in touch as we should be, but it's who I truly, truly am. I guess I'm from there.
Mm.
And then I grew out from then Ghana and came to London to study and work. And that was hard because it was cold and I'm a tropical boy.
Same.
I didn't know anyone here. At first, I was racially attacked really badly.
Okay.
I think I went to a wrong place. I wasn't supposed to be. And this was London in the early 90s.
Mm.
And I was skateboarding and I was in a neighborhood I shouldn't have been in, which I didn't know. And I got thwacked and I got beaten. And
after that,
like, London was never the same. I never liked it. I always wanted to leave. And I was looking for an opportunity to leave, but it was hard back then.
Mm.
And I applied for a job to a company called Dreams Unlimited in Bombay. As one of those, like, you know, you do it as a wishful thing. I used to do websites when I was in London, freelance for a company called Ren Technology. And I wrote to SRK, Shah Rukh Khan, just as a midnight wish type thing. And I sent up the body of my work as a designer and I sent him a heartfelt email about why I thought it would be nice for me to work with him. And in case he was looking for a web designer, he should call me. So I took that leap of faith, just not ever thinking anything would ever come out of it. And shit, you know, 2 weeks later, Shah Rukh Khan himself called me. Mm. At first, I thought it was a joke. Mm. So I hung up. It was not him. It was his manager back then. I think Sushma or something her name was.
Mm.
It was way back then. And she had called me. And I thought it was a joke. I just didn't take it seriously. And then I put the phone down. And then he called me. And I knew it was him because it was a VIP number from India back then.
You hung up on Shah Rukh Khan?
No, I hung up on his assistant, technically. And when I heard his voice, I died because I was also... disclosure, confession. I used to be a big fan when I used to work in London. I used to be a big fan of Shah Rukh Khan, which is why I wrote to him as well.
I used to
go for all his concerts. I used to try and dress like him. I used to try and walk like him. I used to try and talk like him. I even played the guitar because he used to play it in a movie called Dar. Mm. Really badly he used to play it. Like, I don't think he plays guitar. But... I was a big fan.
Yeah.
So to get the opportunity to work with him, none of my friends believed me. They all thought I was like bullshitting them. But I went there and it was a beautiful experience. He was an amazing person. He was a great mentor. And I did really well under his shadow. For 10 years, I learned everything I needed to learn under film. And then in 2007, I was about to make a big Bollywood movie. And I had written the script with a friend of mine called Zoya. Zoya Akhtar is now a big director, but at the time she was struggling to make her first film, which was Luck by Chance. And we both were trying to struggle as young people trying to make it in the industry. And she wanted to make Luck by Chance. And as a female director, she found it very difficult to get an actor back then. It was heartbreaking to watch because there was so much talent within her. And her journey was really strong. And now look at her. It's amazing what she's done.
Smashing it, yeah.
And... Priyanka said yes to my film. Shah Rukh had said yes to my film to act in it. Me and Reema and Zoya, who had scribbled, kicked about it and everything, was excited. And we were like, can't believe this is happening. And then I get deported from India because I had an OCI. Mm. I didn't have an OCI. I had a tourist visa and I was technically not allowed to work on a tourist visa, which is true, my fault. Mm. But I really didn't know it was very stupid of me. But I also thought it was India. They'll fix it. Mm. It'll be done. I'm Indian inherently, so I'll be entitled to a 5-year work visa or something of that sort, is what I assumed.
Yeah.
Little did I know that don't assume these things, you should know them for sure. Hard advice. So I got deported and there was nothing anybody could do. The fact that I worked with Shah Rukh actually made my case worse because he was under scrutiny. For some reason, governments aren't very kind to him. I think also it has to do with his religion. Mm. So it was hard. And it was heartbreaking for him as well because I was in charge of a lot of big projects for him. He tried everything he could to see me come back. You know, you could see how desperate I was because for me, it was like my life was taken away from me.
Yeah.
My girlfriend at that time broke up with me because I was going back to India. I mean, I was leaving the country for 10 years. I was not going to come back. And she wasn't going to come to move to Ghana. Nothing happens in Ghana. So we broke up and I went through a very hard time in that deportation time. But he worked tirelessly to get me back.
Yeah.
And then the 2611 attacks happened in the Taj.
Mm.
And the government changed overnight because there were security lapses and some stupid things happened and some very bad press conferences happened with the politicians and the crowds were angry and the government changed and the new person who came in was more favorable towards Shah Rukh and Muslims and they were from another political party. And instantly my deportation was revoked. I was allowed to come to India and apply for an OCI based on recommendations from big important people who say, okay, we trust him. He's not a bad person. He may have overstayed his visa, but it was an honest mistake.
Mm.
And then I was finally allowed to come back to India. So I think when I was in Ghana, I found myself as a filmmaker there because that's where I took the small format camera and I started shooting because there you didn't have the setup you have when you're working with Shah Rukh. You have nothing.
Mm.
There's no film industry. There's no cameramen. There's no lights. There's nothing. There's no fancy sound studios. Everything had to be done from my bedroom and figuring out painters to like make sets for me and asking friends if they'll act in my commercial and, you know, finding dancers and that's how I kind of, but it was very exciting and I learned the hard way, production value and how much it costs and when my production guys used to scream at me for spending too much money when I was in Bombay, I didn't really understand why they were saying it until I started doing it myself and saw the money being spent. And then you have a deeper understanding
right.
of doing it. And then you're like, oh. And then when I came back to India, they were working on Rawan, which was a very big movie. And I wanted to make this really small, beautiful film on these small cameras. And they were making this big robot film with VFX and 35 cameras and teams from America and teams from Europe. And I'm just like, guys. And right about then is when I got married. And that's when I decided to shoot my wedding video. And that's when I started the wedding film. It was all in this chaotic, turbulent period of life.
Is there anything that you would have tried to change about it all?
So many things. I mean, I really wanted to go to music school. Music is a big part of who I am, and it's something that I really wanted to do. If I was not a filmmaker, I wanted to make music. And music and films they do both go hand in hand. So invariably, I want to do both.
Yeah.
There's only that much music I can create and compose and arrange and work with. And I also work with some really good composers and arrangers back home in Bombay, but it's limited with what I can do with the knowledge that I have. So the dream was to study in Berkeley, but I couldn't afford it back then. But who knows, if I do really well financially, eventually I'd be able to take out some time and fulfill that dream.
Are you doing really well financially at the moment?
Not as well as I should, but not as bad as I could have been. A lot of people had written me off.
Right.
I'm no millionaire, but I get by. I'm comfortable. I can look after the people I love and make sure everything I need is there. But I think it's time now to... with the world, and I see the way the world is working, I think every young, successful or intelligent person should focus on trying to generate some amount of wealth so you can A, give back and create employment, because that's required right now. There are no jobs. And I feel like this can hire people. I can create as many as 50,000 jobs all across the country in India. Because the wedding market is so big, there's so many people. And there's so much to be done content-wise. And there's so many offshoots within wedding spaces that can be shot with. And there's so much of value within the content that we film that is not being really tapped into it. The IPR market, the music market, the OTT platforms, the shows we've worked on with Netflix and Amazon. And there's a lot that can be done. And I think now this next decade is going to be focused on expanding that value.
The reason I asked this question around kind of the financial aspect is because obviously an element of that is required for you to sustain yourself and to be able to continue doing this work. And it's very widely known that being a creative is basically the equivalent of being a starving artist, which is why there's this idea of now like a lot of people doing creative things on the side of like a 9-to-5, and it kind of stops them, including myself, from, you know, being able to fully kind of go all in with it.
I think you know it inside here. It's very easy to lie to yourself. But you know it in here that when you create something, you know the value of it. You know if it's a cheap imitation of something that you've been inspired by, or you know if it's something that you can use to inspire the world around you.
Yeah.
And it's very important to listen to that voice. And that's why I said you have to be true. If you're true, then you won't be able to do it as a side job. You'll dive head in because that voice would be so loud that you wouldn't be able to hear anything else. You will dive head in. You will fail. You will learn from that failure. Life will slap you in the face, but you will get up and you will do it well because you will learn from those mistakes. But that's only if you know inside that what you're doing is true.
Have you seen the London economy, Vishal? Do you think it's feasible to do that in London with the rent prices?
I mean, you can do it anywhere, right? Love happens wherever. At least for me, I can do what I do anywhere because people are going to get married wherever. It's just a matter of making sure that my aesthetics and their aesthetics match, my budgets and their budgets match, and my geographic location and their geographic location matches. I think once these three criteria are met and everything comes into creative processes will come through. The films I filmed in London are very different from the films I film in India. Obviously, the language is different, the way they speak is different, the ceremonies are different, the way the people think and the way they're raised are different. Inherently, they're still getting married. It's still a wedding video. The bride is still going to enter. They're still going to say nice things about and to each other. And they're going to look really fabulous. So,
they are indeed.
So it's about capturing that story. And if they also hired me, then there's something they've seen in my work that they like and they want. So it's to trust that instinct as well.
I want to speak about your creative process now, because it leads on nicely. And I'm super curious, when you take on a wedding, imagine, you know, we're setting the scene, it's the day of, the morning of, obviously there's like probably 3 or 4 or 5 or 7 days of festivities, but on a typical wedding day that you're filming, what is your process like?
It's good to do a walkthrough with your crew. Just go to every corner, look at the space, especially when the light is nice. Even if the wedding won't happen in that light, just to inspire you a little bit, figure out what you can get, where your best angles are. We actually spend some time with the bride and groom, so you know by now who's important, who's not important, and hang around them for a bit. In some cases, we shoot the prep of the wedding. If it's a Sikh wedding, what are the most important parts of a Sikh wedding that the bride and groom don't get to see, especially if they're spiritual or if their parents are really spiritual? The book is really spiritual for them. So I try and make sure we get the entry of the book coming into the space. And, you know, the empty hall, if it's in a gurdwara or if it's on a beach, then, you know, the waves and the sunrise and that magic, I feel like, to create, when you watch your films, you should feel like you're there. And, you know, you see all the things you couldn't really see. The bride can't see the things the groom saw. And the groom can't see the things the bride saw. So if you were the groom, where would you be? You know, how close would you be? How far would you be? How the fly on the wall shot you have, but you also want the details. You don't want to miss them.
Yeah.
And also like different weddings, right? So you have some brides who've got all their friends around them and there's excitement and there's chatter and sometimes there's this hypertest and there's like a nervous breakdown going on, like, oh my God, there's a panic attack happening.
Yeah.
And in some cases, there's like calm and there's beauty and there's peace and there's spirituality and there's just mum and her sitting and looking at old photos before the wedding and crying. And in some cases, there's just joy and peace and happiness and looking for the barat and wanting to be there and not wanting to be alone in the room. So I think it's to identify what kind of person you're filming and try and look for those things that make that person who they are. So that when they're old and they're sad and they're angry and they watch this, they remember that joy and that excitement and how they were when they were younger and try and live like that, because it's always happier to live with a smile on your face than a frown.
That is so impactful.
I know.
I feel like when you're at that age and you're looking back, you probably don't remember any of what actually happened. All you remember is how you felt during that time. And that feeling is what you would recreate.
Right? A lot of our childhood is remembered through the photos we have seen. Yeah. We don't actually remember them that way. You just remember, you think you do, but there's a reference to it. You know, the smell that your mum's food gives you, though, that now.
Yeah, I can remember the smell of my mum's food. So you, of course, have also worked on some really, really high-profile weddings. To name a few, if I can think off the top of my head, there was Sid and Kiara's wedding, which was humongous. Probably one of your most recent really big ones, where Kiara is walking down the aisle and she's doing this movement. What was capturing that moment like for you? What made you decide to actually share that video? Because I know that, you know, there's other celebrity weddings you've done where the videos haven't really been released. So what was that whole kind of experience like working with them?
Well, truly, I wasn't even there for that wedding.
Yeah.
I was there the day before. So I filmed the haldi and the fun bits and the sangeet and the dancing and all of that. And the actual wedding day, I had to leave because I was booked to another wedding. But my crew were there. So we did the rehearsal with Kiara. I was there for that.
What's she like?
She's lovely. She's a really nice, Sindhi, sweet girl getting married. But I had no say in where they would stand, what they wanted to do. The idea is not to direct anyone. I mean, they get directed enough when they make movies. It's their wedding day. They should do exactly what they want. So everything you see is his watch and her pulling and all of that is them. I have no say in that. All we do is capture it. So it's about being at the right place at the right time. Now, you want to be unobtrusive. You don't want to be in their face. You want to be cinematic. So you want to be on the right lens. You want to make sure the light is right. So you want to expose it just right. And then leave the rest to them. And film it with everything you can. And my crew did an exceptional job. She wanted to walk in on a song called Ranja, which is a very sad song. So my only input in that whole situation was, don't walk into something sad. But then she's like, it's our song. And I want it to be, I want it to be our song. I don't want it to be some random Bollywood song or some random song you have made, which also makes sense. if we have a song that we both like listen to and get all emotional on, it's this. So I said, yes, but it's about death and destruction. So she allowed me to change the lyrics. Karan Johar was there at the wedding.
Yeah.
He allowed me to change the lyrics and he gave me the rights to the song instantly. He's like, yeah, please use it.
Mm.
And it just worked. It worked like beautifully. Manish was there. He saw it. He went gaga. The decision to release it is never mine.
Right.
These are not my memories. These are just my memories in my own good way where I keep them to remember them and I can watch them whenever I want because we made them. But I don't ever put them out online unless the bride and groom give us explicit permission to do so. Because some of them are bankers and lawyers and, you know, they don't want to show other people crying or their emotional side.
Yeah, of course.
So they'd rather keep it to themselves and, you know, so to each their own.
Mm. And that comes entirely from them, right? That decision to release.
If they release it, then I release it too because right. it's fun. Then you want to show people your work and what you do and what your crew do really well and people can get excited. It's also inspiring to see. It's nice to see. There's so much of anger and blood and gore and violence online. It's nice to see beautiful things once
Among
in a
while. That, you just have Siddharth Malhotra looking at his watch and everyone's just going nuts over it. That song was absolutely stunning. Mm-hmm. What was the process of creating? And what is the process of creating a unique soundtrack?
Most people who make music will tell you there's no real process to it. It keeps changing depending on the inspiration. So one of my favorite songs we've made is a Sikh wedding song, which revolves around how a Sikh wedding is made. So there's the lavas, there's the feras, which there's the palle, which is before the there's the ardas that happens first. There's no specific bridal entry, but there's a moment we create within music to define that. Then there's the vadaya towards the end. There's another ardas that they have towards the end again, last final prayer. So there's a very clear structure to the wedding and to create music for that structure, because it's also musical as a wedding. If you go to a Sikh wedding, you sit there and there are gyanis who sing and play on the harmonium and the tabla.
Mm.
And that's the wedding, four songs that they sing.
Mm.
And what we try and do is combine those four songs into one epic song. So it's a journey from beginning to end. And then the process of creating the chant and composing each module and each part of it. And it's very exciting.
Mm.
Then some songs, when the bride and groom want to sing a song, or the bride wants to sing a song, and she's a really good singer, but she's never had the opportunity to showcase her talent. Or so at the sangeet, instead of dancing, she'd be like, I'll sing instead.
Mm.
So then we record and we rehearse and we practice. And some cases we do it live, in some cases we do it recorded, so we can use it in the film and in the trailer.
Mm.
And it's beautiful. It's nice to see that they can sing and they can create music with you, which then becomes a very powerful memory, because then those songs become, on their 25th anniversary, they'll dance to that song. When they go for drives, you know, when she's sad, he'll sing her that song.
That's their song.
You know, when they have a baby, she'll sing that song to the baby to put the baby to sleep.
Yeah.
And then it's almost like having your own diamond necklace, but in music form.
Do they own the rights to that song after?
In some cases, if she sang it, then sure.
Mm-hmm.
Then what'll I do with it?
It's true. You have spoken about sort of your process, and we've touched upon some of the couples that you've worked with. How do you select your couples? Do you have a say in that?
I do. It's important to see that a lot of people who have, we're expensive, so there's a budget involved. So that's one screening process. Can they afford it? A lot of people want it, but they can't really afford it. And we try to create products for some people who can't afford it, but it's not easy. It has to be the right fit then.
Right.
In terms of the location, the timing, the number of events they have. If it's a big fat Indian wedding and they can't, then we have to find middle ground. So that's one way. The other reason is we screen them is, do they really want the wedding filmer for the work we do, or do they just want us because, quote unquote, we are the best?
Mm.
Do they have value for the film we make? Will they care when we show it to them later? And will they have appreciation for the amount of time and effort that we create and we put into it? Because you don't want somebody to be unhappy with the product in the end. You want them to, you know, love you for life.
Yeah.
Because you've spent this much of time. Because you would love them for life if you spent this much of time and effort to create it. So do they understand that value? And are they going to be pissy and ask for, like, ridiculous amount of changes in the film and where it's not feasible to do. And then it doesn't become what you created in the first place.
Right.
So it's to look for those people, explain the process to them, make sure there's no hidden cost or hidden fact that they shouldn't be aware of. And they should be okay with all of it. And if there's something they want specifically, that's a good time to tell me so I can start thinking in that direction.
Are you involved in every single wedding that the wedding filmer works on?
I get to see every single wedding and approve every single wedding that every wedding that the wedding filmer works on, yes. It does have my stamp of approval. But I don't get to work on every wedding or shoot every wedding the wedding filmer films now, because now it's a big team and there are lots of people who end up filming. So I try and pick 8 to 10 weddings a year now that I can pick and choose and go for. And then I can spend the rest of my time finishing my script that I'm going to develop so that I can make my film again.
How is that going?
Good. I mean, I spent 3 months in London. I'd not been able to leave with a fully bound script, but I've left with lots of hope ideas and enough of a skeleton to get me going for the next 3 months too. And because this season I'm not overbooking myself and I have enough time to breathe, I'll be able to take some time out to just write for 2 weeks and come up with something that I'll be happy with.
So what you're telling me is you're just like me and you've basically procrastinated for 3 months.
I have, but you know, working in London is hard. You don't have maids, you can't do dishes, and you have to like walk and you have to go to the underground, and it's hard. It's not like India.
It's true. And I'm sure everybody does.
So half my day goes in just like managing my laundry. So by the time I finish laundry and cleaning the house and figuring it out and being housewife, because my girlfriend works in the day.
Yeah.
It's
house boyfriend.
It's hard, yeah.
And yeah, I'm sure everybody does appreciate that there's so much more help when you go back to India. Like, it's just a given, right? There's just help wherever you are.
I have an army back home to help me do the things we need to do.
Yeah. Can you tell us a little bit more then about this project that you're working on? As much as you can share.
It's a dark comedy based around an Indian wedding.
Okay, love that.
That's as much as I can really say.
Yeah.
It's got characters that I've worked with over the past 13 years, people who've inspired me, people who have really noticed, have very powerful stories that need to be told, that are very relatable, that haven't been heard or told before, and that are redone in a very entertaining format. So you get in there and you really have a good time watching this film. It's the kind of film I would like to watch if I do what I do. So
yeah, it sounds like very similar to actually the way that I approach my creative work, which is like, would I want to listen to it? You know, is it something that interests me? And if it doesn't, then I can't sustain that too long, you know?
Exactly.
It's probably why you've come as far as you have with all of the work that you've done.
Think of it as a happy version of Made in Heaven, a not so dark version of Made in Heaven.
Oh, it's a happier version of Made in Heaven.
A happier version.
Wow. So Made in Heaven season 2 came out recently.
It did, didn't it?
And you worked on the wedding filmer worked on the initial sort of sequence, right? That plays at the beginning.
Sets the tone for. The idea is to set the tone to make it feel like this is real life. This is realism. You see the gloss of the wedding, but the show is real life. So I used real life footage to cut the opening titles of the wedding. Zoe is a good friend of mine. She also wrote my script earlier.
Right.
We share ideas whenever we meet. She's a lovely person. And I think she was heavily inspired by what I do for the wedding filmer, which is where the birth of the show came up from. So we went to meet. She wanted me to work with her on the show, but I really couldn't because I was setting up my company and I had to give this focus. But I was willing to help them. So I gave them all the films I made. I gave them a bunch of content. I used to talk to them. I gave them interviews. So they went through stuff. They understood the workings of how I work as a company, because there's a character in the film that's based on me. His name is Kabir.
Okay.
I haven't really seen the show yet, which is really bad of
me. You've not seen Made in Heaven?
I've not had that. I've just not been able to. I'm oversaturated wedding, so I'm going to sit down. My best friend, one of my very close friends, is the actor in it, so I have to watch it.
Okay.
I'm really proud of him for the work he's done in it, and I've heard fabulous things about it. I've never seen it. People hate it. People love it, and I like that people hate it and love it, because it means there's a reaction when you watch it, which means it's done its job. And he's really good at what he does.
Yeah.
He's a fabulous actor.
Well, Zoyakta, if you're listening, then Vishal promises to watch your show soon.
I promise.
Oh my gosh, this is so exciting.
It's always good. No, when I meet somebody who's not watched a TV show that I've really liked,
yeah,
I get excited for them. Like, oh, you're in for a good time. So I'm glad that I've not seen it because
you know what?
I'm waiting for some time to sit down and watch it.
I'm so jealous of you because I want to rewatch it and feel like, you know, I've never seen it before and still feel surprised by all the twists and turns.
I'm waiting for the next bout of COVID or flu or something. Oh, I'll sit down and like do a marathon.
No, we're not jinxing this, no. So I think just maybe to add on to the Sid and Kiara conversation, just because I'm such a Bollywood fanatic and I have to ask you the questions. So you have worked on the weddings of the likes of Deepika Padukone, Ranveer Singh, Farhan Akhtar and Shivani Dandekar, Katrina Kaif, Vicky Kaushal, I could go for ages, Anushka Sharma, Virat Kohli, Arpita Mehta, hers was stunning. I saw some photos from that. What is something that surprises you every time about working on celebrity weddings? What is something people don't know about them?
It's very difficult to work on a celebrity wedding. It's not easy by any standard. Just because they're so used to seeing themselves on screen,
yeah,
that you really have to work very hard to make it look and feel unique for them. So that is not another movie for them that they're in. It's their real life. So you have to impress them with your technique. They've worked with some very talented filmmakers with some very strong budgets. And I guess the expectation, there's a certain expectation that comes with hiring me in terms of the standard and the quality of the storytelling and the film and the detailing. Mm. So I have to bend over backwards to try and be unique because also you don't want, you know, Deepika to show Anushka her wedding film and it to be the same.
But also she's worked with Sanjay Leela Bhansali.
Exactly.
So how do you feel when you're, you know, going into a meeting with them and with your little, you know, piece of like portfolio or ideas and how do you...
It's okay. Now she got a chance to work with Vishal Punjabi.
There you go. Oh my God. I love that. That is a mood. How do you go above and beyond compared to other wedding filming companies?
I think we always do. Whenever I've made music, it's not come from the client or it's not come because they paid me extra for it. It's always come because I felt that emotion at the wedding or it's reminded me of that moment or it's reminded me of that lyric or it's an inspiring part. So we put our souls into these films. If it's the number of hours we shoot for, whether it's, we don't wrap at like 10 o'clock, like most photographers and videographers in the UK, where they work on the hour. We do day and night and party hard with them and, you know, feel for them and cry with them and laugh with them and do what it takes. Even after the film is done, if there's something they want done to change it and to make it more unique for them, we do everything we can to facilitate that. So they have a product that they are proud of.
Right. What about the editing process? Do you think that's a key part?
It's the main part. That's why we are who we are. It's the editors that I work with.
Right.
It's the studio setup we've created. It's the rules and the rules we've made and the rules we've broken that have that makes us who we are. Without the editing films are made on the editing table. Anyone can shoot. In the UK and in the US and in China and in Japan and in Singapore and Thailand. These, you know, Southeast Asian guys and the Vietnamese, and they film so beautifully. Such great cameramen. We don't have the best cameramen in the world. But good footage will only get you that much.
Yeah.
It's what you do with that footage that makes the magic.
Is there any film you've worked on that you've really hate the video of? I mean, you don't have to share which one, but are there any like that?
Well, yeah, there's something you do that are very uninspiring. They're not really fun. Or you can see this is not a wedding that should have happened.
Oh, God.
Something went wrong. And
what went wrong? Tell us the goss.
Oh, I did a wedding. So many weddings you've done. And sometimes they're not the right ones to do. And you somehow got it wrong. You got the formula wrong. And then you're just like, I should be here. But then you swallow the pill. This is what you do for a living. So you win some, you lose some. You try and win more than you lose. And it's fine.
Are there any couples that are no longer together that you've worked with?
So many.
Really? What's the percentage roughly?
That was nice because in the beginning, for the first 4 years, I think everything was going strong. And I'm like, oh, this is amazing. I can use this as a marketing ploy. If you get the wedding filmer, you won't get divorced. My statistics say that. And then I was wrong.
You were wrong.
Yeah, I mean, the wedding filmer got divorced. So that was a that was a hard one. And I think the biggest thing at that time was, oh shit, log kya kahenge?
Yeah.
Which translates to, oh shit, what would people say?
What did people say?
I don't know. I didn't give a fuck. But I was also like, I did give a fuck, but I was closed in a, for the longest time, I didn't even tell anyone. Mm. I'd go on shoot and people would ask me, so how's your wife? And I'm like, oh, she's great. She's fine. I did not try and change the subject. Like, I wouldn't say that I was divorced. And when I started saying I was divorced, it became even harder.
Did people stop hiring you after they realized you got divorced?
No.
Right.
Thankfully.
Love that.
No. No, I don't think they cared. I think I overthought it maybe more, but there's also a stigma. I think yes. When you start dating people, you realize again, it's like, oh, he's divorced. It's a thing. Like, there must be something wrong.
Right.
Which is why he's
or divorced. Like Kala Jadu or something.
Not Kala Jadu so much, but it's also like, oh, it's like almost taboo, no?
Yeah.
It's like, oh, he's divorced. It's like, there's something wrong. Like, he's like, I had his hand amputated.
or maybe he's just seen all aspects of life and he's just a guy.
I mean, to me, it's just another breakup with a piece of paper involved. We were dating. Mm-hmm. We shouldn't have been married. We were young. Right. I was stupid. She was stupid.
Right.
We both weren't meant to be together. So it was hard at the time. But now in retrospect, she's way happier and I'm very happy.
Mm.
And
how have you grown as a person after that experience?
You shrink a little and then you grow and then you shrink a little and then you grow. And I think that shrinking is also important. We can't just constantly keep growing all the time. You won't give your body time to expand. You get stretch marks.
Mm.
So it's good to shrink a little and then grow a little and then shrink a little and then grow a little.
Mm. So work in progress.
Constant work in progress.
How do you deal with the pressure of things like same day edits, you know, the pressure of needing to produce by a certain period of time? The wedding industry is very competitive. How do you manage your own health during that?
So there's a thing about hiring people is you kind of suss out why they're on, and you're also very clear with them and how long it will take, whether they're willing to wait. If they're not willing to wait, then you don't take the project, because some things take the time it does need to take the time. I don't do same day edits just for anyone and everyone. We take our time with it and we really select the couples we want to film for and the people we can put that amount of energy into it. It depends on the structure of the wedding, what they want to show on the same day edit. But I do have a really solid, supremely talented team that I have handpicked and trained over the past 13 years. And now they're training the new people who are coming on board and it's growing. It's beautiful.
Right. Do you have to like your clients?
You really do.
Yeah.
Because you're going to spend 6 months, sometimes 3 months, sometimes 4 months with these people making music for them.
Yeah.
Watching them over and over and over again.
Yeah.
In slow motion in 4K.
Yeah. So you kind of have to not hate yourself when you
want to make sure you do it right.
So we were speaking about, I guess, the pressures of the industry.
Mm.
And
you don't take pressure, you give pressure if you're an artist.
What's your tactic of pushing back where you don't agree necessarily with the couples or, you know, what they're asking for and you think, oh, that's probably not going to look very good? How do you approach that?
Well, you tell them, you be honest with them and you be straight with them.
Mm.
It's not hard for them to understand. I'm a good explainer.
Mm.
I talk a lot so people can understand why. I think, but most of the times, 99.9% of the time, people are happy with what they get.
Because
there's a strong understanding of why we do what we do.
Yeah.
Which is why we don't ever face these problems. If there is, then I bend backwards to make sure I understand why they want. In some cases, I do get it wrong.
Mm.
I picked the wrong language in a song once. Yeah, I mean, I assumed the bride was Telugu, but she was actually Tamil. And I used the Telugu version of the song.
Oh, no.
But it's okay. I just switched the language and we made it work. I had a Tamil version of it too, so I switched it. Or in some cases, you know, there's a girl they've not liked or they've fallen out of after the wedding. One of the bridesmaids is being a bitch. So she's like, please take her out of the film. I don't want to see her anymore.
How do you take her out? Oh, you just...
Edit bits out where she's in it. And
wow. People do that?
Yeah. Like, oh, I don't like that Masi. Can you take her out? She's a bitch. And that's easy to do. It's not hard. And at least you do it and then the film doesn't become unwatchable for them. They're proud of what they watch. And every time they watch it, they're happy.
Mm.
You don't cringe.
Mm.
You don't want them to cringe when they watch their wedding video.
Mm. That's very true. Yes. Yes, it is their wedding video after all. Tell me, Vishal, are you a perfectionist in your work?
I used to be. I've learned to give up control for me to be able to have a life and for me able to be able to grow the company. Because if I micromanage everything every time, I wouldn't be able to grow. There are other things I need to do for me to grow the company in terms of marketing, in terms of investment, in terms of thinking bigger, looking at the bigger picture and, you know, finding new ways of telling stories and, you know, working on new technologies. I can't do that if I'm micromanaging everyone's edit every time. So now there are ways of giving up control. But in doing so, at the beginning it was difficult. But if you do it diligently well and in a structured form, you can see that you're giving way to creative ideas that would never have come if I was at the helm of it alone.
Right.
Because the young ones who are doing it now have a lot to prove.
Yeah.
So they're working extra hard to prove that they can do things better than I can.
Mm.
And they're very resourceful.
Mm. And do you also think that they bring things to the table that you might not? Because yes, they have that sort of Gen Z millennial sort of
and the energy, you know, the hunger. I'm not as hungry now. I've made it. I'm doing well. Like people hire me. I don't have to look for clients.
Mm.
You know, they're still hungry. They're still learning. And they're still wanting to prove themselves every day. So the extra mile and the hard work and the sleepless nights they put in is the reason we are doing well today.
How amazing. It's always a team around you, isn't it?
Yeah.
What hopes and aspirations do you have for the wedding filmer in the coming 10, 20 years?
I would like for it to become like the Starbucks for wedding films.
Is it not already the Starbucks of wedding films in India?
Yeah, right now it's the Hakkasan of wedding films in India. It's too expensive.
Is that not better?
It's okay, expensive. Fair. So not everyone can go to Hakkasan and enjoy that meal. Only the people who have appreciated, I guess.
Mm.
I guess now you want to make it more accessible for people without it losing its value and its core belief of making a good, decent memory that the couples can be proud of.
Yeah. Is there any innovation that you hope to introduce in your films? Any changes? I know you've been doing, you know, VR stuff, 360 videos, all of that.
Yeah, it's been fun. I mean, we keep playing with new technologies all the time. Music, 360s and drones came, and then VR came, and it's lots of fun. Now AI has come, and we use AI to help us subtitle our films, to help us organize our shots, to help us with graphics and plates and so many things. Like it's really helpful.
Mm.
Even with sound, like it helps to clear the audio and give us unmixes and remix the audio and add beats to certain things and get, like, you know, create soundtracks from text, which is amazing.
Mm.
Things we couldn't have dreamt of before.
That's true. Yeah. So just, you know, that initial effort that you
put
in. If
you could think it now, you can create it. So it's getting easier and better and cooler and more difficult as well in the same breath.
That's super inspiring. For anyone who wants to start a wedding videography company today, what should they not do?
Start small. And don't imitate the people you have seen around you. Try and find your own voice and the kind of stories you want to tell and the kind of filmmaking you want to do. It's filmmaking. It's a canvas. So you can create whatever you want.
Mm.
Is it from the point of view of the nani who's making the jalebis in the kitchen in the morning, singing that song?
Well, jalebi baby. In 20 years, it probably will be.
Yeah, I mean, either that or, you know, just singing some traditional song in the morning.
Yeah.
Making sweets and, you know, the girl is doing her hair and she's putting flowers in her hair. And
yeah.
You can make some really interesting films with just where you are and what you do.
Mm.
And how do you want to tell your story?
Work with what you've got.
To talk about, yeah. And yeah. It's fun. Start small. Don't invest too much. It's not about the camera. It's not about the lens. You know, it's not about anybody can shoot with a nice camera and a lens. It's about how you tell your story, the tone of it.
How beautiful. I love that. Vishal, I'm still thinking back to when we went for that coffee, and I really just wanted to share something that on that day, I think it was like raining a lot that
day. It was.
And we met up and you pulled out your iPad and you were just like, oh, do you want to watch some videos? And I remember you pulled out the Ranveer Singh and Deepika Padukone video and you said, no one's seen this before. And I was watching it and I was just like, is this actually my life? Like, what? You have created so much magic for so many people. And I feel like you've really kind of solidified and immortalized a lot of this love, you know, even if the love doesn't stay because for whatever reason, they're not together anymore, that moment is captured forever. And I think that's such a beautiful thing that you're doing.
Thank you.
And I want to thank you for it because you've made us all feel such a type of way, you know, watching those videos. I remember when Heartbeats came out, that was the kind of back in the day, the big one.
Yeah.
And I remember watching it in the dark in my duvet and just be like crying my eyes out. And like, that's the impact that I think you probably don't even realize that you kind of generated those emotions, not just in the family and the couple, but also in the people who are, you know, privy to it.
I get very lucky with the people I film for. They share so much. Some of them, like Devrat and Kanika from Heartbeats. It was very early in my wedding film, and they're very private, personal people. But because he was a friend of mine, he knew I was setting up my company. I did his wedding for very cheap. He understood the value of what I was doing. He heard the song I made. He was very touched by it all, and he was very grateful, and there's only gratitude from him. He was very gracious. He let me put it up online, despite him being embarrassed about his wedding video being online.
Yeah.
And it put us on the map. That gesture of his made my company what it is today. So there's a lot of goodness that's come in from everybody around me, the couples we film for, the people who I work with. And that's, despite all the hardships you face in running a company and being a divorced wedding videographer, it still comes out shining because you've just got this love and support from everybody. You've got lots of gratitude for what you're creating, and that's nice. It makes it easier to do what I do.
Absolutely. And I feel like you're not just doing it, you're thriving in it. You're creating art, you're creating things that don't already exist. And yeah, and I think that's, just keep doing that. Please don't stop.
Thank you.
Last question for you, Vishal. What do you have strong game in?
What do I have strong game in? I have strong game in being that chameleon, just being able to, I've always required, I think as an Indian who grows up overseas, like a lot of Indians grow up overseas just because of the way the country was shaped. We have to keep adapting ourselves to different situations and different places. So I've become very strong at doing that. I can talk like a Ghanaian man. I can eat the Ghanaian food, which is why after this interview in Hackney, I'm going to go there and I'm going to chop the jollof and the wache and the fufu. I don't know whether I'll chop the jollof and the wache and the fufu, or is it an or is it an and? We'll find out. But I can also talk like a proper person from India. And I can also talk to you the way I'm supposed to.
You're doing it better than me.
So I guess you have to learn how to fit in, and then also find who you truly are and not get confused in trying to adapt all the time for different people.
Are there any final words you'd like to leave us with?
I wish I was that witty. I guess no, if you're watching this and you want to be a wedding videographer, start small. If you're getting married, call me. I'm available. Don't be intimidated because of the weddings we've done. And to you, I'm really proud of what you've done with this show and having me over and talking to me for an hour about my life. And I'm grateful I got a chance to open my circle a little bit in London, because now I plan on being here for 6 months a year. So it's a perfect life to live, isn't it? Because you have the summer in London when the weather's been really nice between, I think it came in May till now, and you spent 5-6 months here and it's great. And then when September hits and it starts getting cold and wedding season starts picking up, and then it's Diwali and then it's all the fun festivals and Navratri and Dashera, and so you go back to India for that and you stay there for winter, and then in March we come back here again.
I love that for you, and I'm excited to see what you're going to do more of and to see you more in London as well.
Yeah, cool.
Doing awesome things. Thank you so much once again, Vishal, for coming, for sharing your story, for talking to us for an hour. I could go for three more. I literally did not even touch the surface of my questions, but thank you once again.
We'll do this again.
Definitely.
Hopefully after I've made my film and I'm here next year.
Oh my God, yeah.
Chat back and be like, what was it like making this film?
I look forward to that. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for listening to this episode of Brown Game Strong. I really hope you enjoyed it. If you'd like to stick around, then please do hit the subscribe button if you're listening on YouTube. And do give the social links a follow as well. We're on Instagram and on TikTok. If you have any thoughts, feedback, advice, any potential guests that you'd like to hear me speak to, then please do drop a note on either the socials or on browngamestrong@gmail.com. Thank you once again for listening, and really appreciate your support.